thank you to John and Kimberly for your leadership last week while I was away. Tonight we're going to continue this exploration of the Sermon on the Mount that we've been doing for the past several weeks. And we've had this emphasis, too, on John Wesley and what he had to say about Jesus' sermon in his own 13 sermons on the topic. And so, as a matter of introduction for those of you who might not have been with us and a reminder for the rest of us, I just want to keep before us the three sections, the three movements, if you will, that happen in Jesus' sermon. First, in Matthew chapter 5 is where he defines for us what true religion is, what it looks like. And then he follows that in chapter 6, where Jesus then tells us the ways that we might live into his idea of true religion. And then finally in chapter 7, he warns us against the hindrances which can prevent us from living into true religion. So tonight we're still in chapter 6, and when we last met, we discussed Matthew 6, 19 through 23, the passage which includes where your heart is, there your heart will be also, and Wesley's 8th sermon. Tonight our scripture is Matthew 6, 24 through 34, so listen to these words from Jesus. No one can serve two masters. Either you will hate the one and love the other, or you will be loyal to the one and have contempt for the other. You cannot serve God and wealth. Therefore, I say to you, don't worry about your life, what you'll eat or what you'll drink, or about your body, what you'll wear. Isn't life more than food and the body more than clothes? Look at the birds in the sky. They don't sow seed or harvest grain or gather crops into barns, yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Aren't you worth much more than they are? Who among you by worrying can add a single moment to your life? And why do you worry about clothes? Notice how the lilies in the field grow. They don't wear themselves out with work and they don't spin cloth. But I say to you that even Solomon, in all of his splendor, wasn't dressed like one of these. If God dresses grass in the field so beautifully, even though it's alive today and tomorrow is thrown into the furnace, won't God do much more for you, you people of weak faith? Therefore, don't worry and say, what are we going to eat, or what are we going to drink, or what are we going to wear? Gentiles long for all these things. Your heavenly Father knows that you need them. Instead, desire first and foremost God's kingdom and God's righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. Therefore, stop worrying about tomorrow, because tomorrow will worry about itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own. Which master do you serve? That is the title of Wesley's 9th discourse on the Sermon on the Mount, and it's the question that he wants his hearers to answer. And as with his 8th discourse, Wesley wastes no time challenging his audience. He begins his sermon with a reference to the book of 2 Kings in the Old Testament and how the nations of that time had a certain fear of the Lord and showed as much through their service to him, all while they worshipped their idols. After a brief introduction, Wesley fires this shot. How nearly does the practice of most modern Christians resemble this of the ancient heathens? They fear the Lord. They also performed an outward service to him and hereby show they have some fear of God, God with a capital G. But they likewise serve their own gods, gods with a little g. Hence his question, which master do you serve? Now Jesus' own answer to this question is that you cannot serve more than one master. You will hate one and love the other. Be loyal to one and have contempt for the other. You cannot serve God and wealth, as the passage is translated in the Common English Bible that you had in your bulletin. Now, the King James Version text, which Wesley was preaching from, reads this way. You cannot serve God and Mammon. M-A-M-M-O-N. Mammon was the name of one of the heathen gods. And as Wesley put it, it is here understood of riches themselves, gold and silver, money, pleasure, and all the greed-filled temptations that come with such things. Now, I would go ahead and invite us to, as we're listening to this, yes, the focus is on wealth and riches and silver and gold and money and things that money can buy, but let's look at this purely as any of the idols that we might have in our life, any of the small g gods that might get our attention more than the big G God. Wesley strives to help us understand what it means to serve the big G God and what it means to serve mammon and why it's impossible to serve both. He begins by asking, what does it mean to serve God? Well, first, serving God means, quite simply, believing in Him. We cannot serve God unless we believe in God. And believing in God implies that we trust in God as the center of our life. Second, serving God means loving God. And the manner in which God requires us to love God is as the one God, the one true God, with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength. Next, serving God means imitating God. Wesley quoted an ancient father in his sermon, and this quote is great. He said, "It is the best worship or service of God to imitate Him you worship." So if God is love, we seek to resemble God's love. We imitate God by being merciful and kind and benevolent and compassionate and tender-hearted. And finally, serving God means obeying God. We do what God says. We avoid what God forbids and perform all the everyday, ordinary actions of life with, you might remember this from the last time we were together, a single eye toward God and with a pure heart, offering ourselves as a living sacrifice. So after he spells that out, Wesley then asks, what then does it mean to serve mammon? First, serving mammon means trusting in riches. This implies that we trust the world for our happiness rather than God as the very source of our life. And like I said, we can insert riches, or we can make the fill in the blank there. We trust blank for our happiness, than God as the very source of our life. Second, serving mammon means loving the world, setting our hearts upon that the world offers and placing our joy in those things. Next, serving mammon means conforming to the world. As Wesley put it, to be of an earthly, sensual mind, chained down to the things of the earth, to be self-willed and inordinate lovers of ourselves. Inordinate lovers of ourselves. And finally, serving mammon means obeying the world. It means walking as others walk, on the common road, on the broad, smooth, beaten path, to be in fashion, to follow the multitude, to do like our neighbors do, to gratify our appetites and inclinations, to aim at our own ease and pleasure, to be cool, to keep up with the Joneses, that kind of thing. So after making these distinctions, what it's like to serve God, what it's like to serve mammon, Wesley then asks a very pointed question. Now, what can be more undeniably clear than that we cannot thus serve God and mammon? He answers his own question by making these points, which I am both summarizing and paraphrasing. We cannot serve both comfortably. By attempting to serve both, we are sure to be disappointed in both and unable to find rest in one or the other. We cannot serve both consistently. Serving both will always result in taking one step forward and then one step back. One step forward, one step back. We cannot serve both without being contrary. Wesley said that the contrary nature of the most opposite things on earth, fire and water, darkness and light, that those things vanish into nothing when compared to the contrary nature of God and mammon, God and idol worship. So I say, yes, Mr. Wesley, you've made your point, and you've made it well. We cannot serve God and mammon. Now, I must tell you, all of what we've just been talking about was the first verse out of those 10, verse 24. And when I first sat down to study tonight's passage in Wesley's sermon, I thought it was quite odd that Wesley began with verse 24 and spent so much time on it, for that matter. Because when I've preached this message in the past, I picked up with verse 25. 25 to 34. And most translations, when you pick up a Bible and open it to this chapter, they divide the text and place a paragraph title immediately before verse 25. So the Common English Bible does this, and it says, worry about necessities, and then goes right into verse 25. So that means verse 24 many times would be included as the final verse of the preceding section. Thus, it would have made sense for verse 24 to be part of the last sermon. You guys with me? Okay. But I ended up learning why it made perfect sense that Wesley began with verse 24. First, verse 25 begins with the word therefore. And as I was taught in seminary, whenever you see the word therefore in the Bible, you must ask yourself, what is it there for? Okay? Because generally there's been this grand explanation of something, and it's followed by a therefore you must, or you know, you have to pay attention to what precedes there. And so Wesley does answer that question, what's it there for, in the rest of his sermon. And Jesus and Wesley both answer this question. And I imagine them saying it something like this: I've made it pretty clear that you cannot worship God and anything else. Name your favorite idol. So now you have to decide. And I hope you decide to worship God rather than insert your favorite idol. Now, Eugene Peterson's paraphrase of verses 25 to 34, I think, get it absolutely right. He writes this. And remember now, this is where the therefore is, okay? So, therefore, if you decide for God, living a life of God worship, it follows that you don't fuss about what's on the table at mealtimes or whether the clothes in your closet are in fashion. There is far more to your life than the food you put in your stomach, more to your outer appearance than the clothes you hang on your body. Look at the birds, free and unfettered, not tied down to a job description, careless in the care of God. And you count far more to him than birds. Has anyone, by fussing in front of the mirror, ever gotten taller by so much as an inch? All this time and money wasted on fashion, do you think it makes that much difference? Instead of looking at the fashions, walk out into the fields and look at the wildflowers. They never crimp or shop. But have you ever seen color and design quite like it? The 10 best-dressed men and women in the country look shabby alongside them. If God gives such attention to the appearance of wildflowers, most of which are never even seen, don't you think he'll attend to you, take pride in you, do his best for you? What I'm trying to do here is get you to relax. To not be so preoccupied with getting, so you can respond to God's giving. People who don't know God and the way he works fuss over these things, but you know both God and how he works. I love this. Steep your life in God reality, God initiative, God provisions. Don't worry about missing out. You'll find all your everyday human concerns will be met. Give your entire attention to what God is doing right now. And don't get worked up about what may or may not happen tomorrow. God will help you deal with whatever hard things come up when the time comes. Now, how many of us here are willing to say we've made a decision for God over idols? Okay, three of us. That's a little scary. How many of us here are willing to say they've made a decision for God over idols? Okay, a few more. The peer pressure is building. The hands are going up. Now keep your hands up if you never worry about anything. You don't ever worry about anything? Andrew, you don't ever? Well, good for you, man. I worry. Because worrying is hard, right? I mean, speaking for myself, I can tell you that when things are really, really good in my life, it's really easy to trust God. It's really easy to believe that God is in control. But when life becomes difficult and hectic and chaotic and hard, my faith wavers and I worry and I stress. A book that changed my life was a book called Crazy Love. And it was written by Francis Chan. And in it, he writes some things that are very relevant to this conversation. The second chapter was titled, "You Might Not Finish This Chapter." You must know where I'm going. He starts the chapter by saying, "You could die before finishing this chapter." I could die while you're reading it, today, at any moment, but it's easy to think about today as just another day. An average day where you go about life concerned with your to-do list, preoccupied by appointments, focused on family, thinking about your desires and needs. On the average day, we live caught up in ourselves. On the average day, we don't consider God very much. On the average day, we forget that our life truly is a vapor. And I think that Francis could have added there to that paragraph, on the average day, we forget that God is in control, and we worry and stress ourselves out. But Francis goes on to say this about worry and stress. Worry implies that we don't quite trust that God is big enough, powerful enough, or loving enough to take care of what's happening in our lives. Stress says that the things we are involved in are important enough to merit our impatience, our lack of grace toward others, or our tight grip of control. Now, the truth is that worry and stress about tomorrow prevent us from living. And I mean really living. Living into the true religion that Jesus, a few paragraphs, another chapter ago, defined for us. We're prevented from living for today. And Wesley said, "The past is as nothing, as though it has never been. The future is nothing to you. It is not yours. Perhaps it never will be. There is no depending on what is yet to come, for you know not what a day may bring forth. Therefore, live today. Lose not an hour. Use this moment, for that is your portion." That is your portion. That means we should worry less and love more, stress less and pray more, and follow hard after God the Father who made us and the rest of the world, God the Son who saved us and the rest of humankind, and God the Holy Spirit who guides and sustains our journey toward becoming more fully who we are called. So let us pray now this prayer from Praying in the Wesleyan Spirit. This prayer Paul Chilcote wrote based on Wesley's ninth discourse. O Lord and Master of all humanity, we cannot love you fully if our heart is divided. If we have more than one master, we will always be pulled in different directions. To serve you and you alone is first and foremost to believe in you. To trust in you as our strength, help, shield, and defender. To trust you as our happiness. To trust in you as the end toward which all of life moves. To serve you also means to love you and you alone. To love you as the one God. To desire you alone for your own sake. To rejoice and delight in you forever. To serve you is to imitate you in our heart and life. To serve you is to obey you by keeping your commandments and to make the law of love the guiding force in our life. Therefore, we will not trust in riches or love the world, conforming our life to the values and standards of this age, rather than being transformed by the power of your self-giving love. We will seek nothing but you, O God. And we will not worry about our own life and what we need, for we know that you will take care of us. We will work hard to care for one another, but we will not allow concerns for the things of this world to take control of our life. We will seek above all else the realization of your reign in our heart and the fruit of your love in our life, for we know that if we entrust our life to you and your ways, then you will provide all we need to be happy and contented in life. We will live as in the light of eternity, but keep our eyes focused upon the present and its actions, rather than upon the future and its dreams. This day, this moment, this hour, we will pursue nothing but love, serving and enjoying